Good evening, everyone. Greetings from Manipal University. And bountiful of thanks to the organizing committee for having invited me here. Well, my topic for today's presentation is oral malignancies in young cohorts. Malignancies, or in a layman's term, cancer, is an abnormal growth of cells, the growth of which exceeds and is uncoordinated with that of the normal tissue even after the cessation of the stimuli that has evoked the change. Now, when you see a normal cell division, it's a highly regulated mechanism that is controlled by genes made up of DNA. Now, exposure to the carcinogenic agents, they induce mutations in the DNA. And over a period of time, these cells, they become malignant by acquiring various characteristic features, like they invade into the blood vessels and nerves, that is, and cause distant metastasis, or they create their own factory of blood vessels, that is, angiogenesis, and lastly, they evade the process of programmed cell death. Now all this leads to an unlimited replication of cells, and these cells, they become immortal. Now earlier, the predators of oral cancer, now they seem to be individuals, usually middle-aged and elderly individuals, those who are habituated to tobacco and alcohol. Gradually, there has been a paradigm shift in the clinical profile, epidemiology, prognosis and treatment of oral cancer, with HPV emerging as a distinct clinical entity in younger individuals. So there could be various reasons, like multiple sex partners or multiple oral sex or an early sexual intercourse. So these are the reasons why HPV is being emerging as a distinct clinical entity in these younger individuals who are non-smokers and non-alcoholics. Now let's brush up the anatomy of the oral cavity, because HPV-induced oral cancers, they commonly affect the oropharynx. Now when we look at the clinical, pathological and molecular progression of oral cancer, there are red signals that are thrown up by the human body in the form of maybe persistent red or white patches, hyperplasia, dysplasia or non-healing ulcers. But more often they seem to be inconspicuous and hidden in the cryptic locations of the oral cavity. Also, the lack of awareness of dentists and physicians in recognizing these early malignant ulcers that camouflage as traumatic ulcers, making diagnosis a delayed one. Now just look at the population of India. It's blowing out of proportion. India has a rapidly growing population that is inflicted with a cancer diagnosis. Now from an estimated incidence of 1.45 million in the year 2016, it is expected to reach about 1.75 million in the year 2020. Excluding skin cancer, oral cancer is the most common form of cancer in the head and neck region. The yearly incidence of oral cancer is about 3 lakh worldwide. Now, a glimpse of the scary statistics of cancer in India. Tobacco will kill more than 8 million people worldwide each year by the year 2030, with 80% of these premature deaths in the low and middle-income countries. Uttar Pradesh, the most productive populated state in India, is right now sitting on an oral cancer epidemic. Tobacco is the only product in the world which can do nothing else but just harm the people, except for earning revenue worth few millions to the government. The cancer prevention cost less than 15 paisa per person, which is a minuscule portion of rupees 5 lakh that is being spent on cancer care. So at this era, we can say that cancer can happen at any age, sex or race, and most of them are preventable. Now a glance through the average walking patients at some of the premier cancer institutes in India, we have King's George Medical University with an average 300 OPD patients per day. Then we have Tata Memorial Hospital around 200, and then Sanjay Gandhi Postgraduate Institute of Medical Science, Lucknow, about 150 walk-in patients, and then Regional Cancer Center, Trivandrum, about 80 patients. So WHO report states that cancer is rapidly sweeping through India, with nearly one cancer happening one every 50 seconds. Indeed, it is emerging as a new Y2K killer. The changing Indian scenario is, in India, cancers are unique. They respect no boundaries or barriers. Most of these cancers are aggressive and advanced at presentation. Now there are some other innoxious risk factors that can be related to cancer. Obesity, diet, stress and physical inactivity. They have all been documented as an established, modifiable and preventable cancer risk factor. Also, there are studies that have quoted the role of periodontal disease in oral cancer. The dysbiotic oral flora that is seen in the periodontal disease can support the host defense mechanism, and it can lead to a plethora of systemic diseases. Now, we all need, now as human beings, we all need a smooth transition in our wheel of life, that is from birth to death. But when there is a sudden interruption in this space and it brings you one step closer to death, as perceived by our patients, there is always a state of fear. Now, adolescence is often considered as the healthiest stage of life. It sits between the peaks of an early life mortality and of chronic disease in a late adulthood. It's the most healthiest phase where young individuals are yet to blossom. Sexuality, intimacy and reproduction, they are all central in this phase. But most of the common questions that are lingering in our patients' mind is, I am too young to have cancer. No one in my family has cancer. I don't drink, I don't alcohol. These are the common questions that these young individuals ask, and sometimes it's very difficult to answer these questions. So thus, oral cancer cannot be discounted in younger patients. Stereotyping patients based on their age and traditional risk factor should no more be a norm. Psychological impact. Now the diagnosis of cancer is a traumatic. It is not a discrete, singular, stressful experience. Rather, it entails a cascade of multiple traumatic events, right from diagnosis, treatment, side effects, and ongoing concerns of recurrence and metastasis. Also, the caregivers of these patients are considered to be the secondary patients. Now, human papillomavirus, the most emerging distinct clinical entity in these younger individuals, now they produce proteins like E6 and E7. E6 is the one which is responsible for inhibition of the tumor suppressor activity of E53, and E7 is the one which inhibits the activity of retinoblastoma protein. Now all this leads to an unlimited replication of cells. Human papillomavirus have a basic predilection to the basal keratinocytes. Now in infections of the anogenital region, usually the O9 stratified squamous epithelium, now they protect the basal keratinocytes. However, the friction that is being produced during a sexual intercourse provides an access to the basal keratinocytes because the stratified squamous epithelium gets abraded. However, in the palatine and the lingual tonsils, these basal keratinocytes are naturally exposed, and thus it explains the proclivity of HPV in these areas. So when we compare the HPV-induced oral cancers and non-HPV-induced oral cancers, in HPV-induced oral cancers, the predators are younger, they are non-smokers and non-alcoholics, they have an improved survival rate. The site is most commonly the oropharynx and the epithelium of the aerodigestive tract. They have a distinct molecular signature and there is an absence of field cancerization. So when we look at the primary, secondary and tertiary prevention of HPV viruses, now in infections of the cervical region, we have primary vaccines that are being much effective when compared to the primary vaccines in cases of HPV-induced oral cancers. Secondary prevention is, the aim is to detect the disease usually at the incipient stage. Now in infections of the cervical region, we can do a brush biopsy because cervical region is a flat epithelial surface, easy to sample. But in case of palatine and the lingual tonsils, they are very difficult to reach. Efficacy of these tonsillar brushing also seems to be limited. Over a period of time, maybe prophylactic tonsillectomy might be a norm in these individuals. And then we have tertiary prevention, like antibodies can be detected. Okay, now when we look at these cases, now the first thing that comes in our mind that most of these Indian cancers are unique, be it the site, the location, and the stage of presentation. Now the term insanity, it seems to be synonymous with the treatment of oral cancer. Insanity means doing the same thing again and again and expecting a different result. The same holds good for the treatment of oral cancer. For almost a century, we have been treating the disease with the same cut, burn, poison therapy, that is surgery, chemotherapy and radiation. However, there has been an improvement in the quality of life with the advances in the microvascular reconstruction and use of free labs. However, the overall 5-year survival rate is still hovers around 50 to 60%. So what should be the reason? One of the most common reasons is diagnostic delay. So the diagnostic delay can be of three types, that is patient delay, professional delay and system delay. Patient delay is an interval between the first symptom that is noticed by the patient to a visit to the healthcare provider. So some of the patients receive herbal treatment, some have a callous attitude towards oral hygiene, some have other social responsibilities and hence there's a delay. Professional delay is an interval between the examination by the healthcare provider to the final histopathological diagnosis. Now we should know that cancer patients, they often enter into a matrix environment in which there are multiple professionals who will be providing care at different stages of treatment and recovery. there are advantages. Suppose like there's a good transition in care from one physician to another. It provides a fresh overview of the patient's condition. You can change a treatment plan, or you can detect a previously undetected problem. But all this can contribute to a delay in the diagnosis. A summation of this, that is patient delay and professional delay, is called a system delay. Now let's go through some interesting cases. Now the first case is an oral cancer that is being linked to an early coitus, that is a sexual intercourse. It was published in British Dental Journal. So here is a 20-year-old pregnant, 20-year-old lady. She presented to us with a non-healing ulcer in the left lateral border of the tongue. On examination, there was initially she reported to a local physician who attributed this ulcer to an erupting third molar. However, there was further progression in the symptoms with dysphagia, there was hoarseness in the voice, and then she was referred to us for further management. On examination, you see an indurated, erosive, endophytic ulcer that is located in the left lateral border of the tongue. Axial CECT shows a left-sided tongue-based carcinoma that is extending approximately in midline. Another interesting case of tuberculosis, diabetes, and tongue cancer. She was a 28-year-old lady who initially complained of a non-healing ulcer in the left lateral border of the tongue. She was a known tuberculosis patient. Failure in remission of the symptoms with further difficulty in swallowing, she reported to us, and then she had discontinued her tuberculosis treatment due to financial constraints, but frequency of frequent bouts of cough and sleeplessness, and then compelled her to restart the treatment. During the course of the treatment, she had progressed to a diabetic state. So diabetes and tuberculosis are often interrelated. Tuberculosis, diabetes, and then she had succumbed to tongue cancer. So in these patients, you should remember that overlapping toxicities must be considered. Human body is not an impermeable fortress. That means for every pill that we are infusing, there is an ill that is associated with it. Another interesting case of a 9-year-old boy who was happily chewing a smokeless tobacco. Now smoking in India is frowned upon, but smokeless tobacco can be easily chewed in. Now tobacco is known for its euphoric and energizing action, and this seems to boost the endurance of the person, leading to a habitual consumption. Another interesting case of oral cancer in a pregnant lady. A 29-year-old lady at 14 weeks of gestation presented to us with a poorly differentiated squamous cell carcinoma in an area of erythroleukoplakia. The ixilateral muscle, that is genioglossus muscle, was involved with level 2A lymph nodes and metastasis. She was diagnosed with T4A N1 M-stage. A right hemiplosectomy with bilateral level 1 forward neck dissection was done, and reconstruction was done with a 3 flap, that is radial forearm flap. So there are 3 treatment considerations you can consider in these patients. Either you can continue the pregnancy with the standard treatment of malignancy, or you can continue with the premature delivery followed by a resection of the primary malignancy while pregnant, with neck dissection after delivery, or third one is termination of pregnancy. So that depends on the patient decision. So conclusion is, profile of HPV patients are distinct in terms of risk factors, clinical and demographic characteristics, and prognosis. It is also imperative for clinicians to maintain a healthy index of suspicion for lesions in patients who are not at risk, and not to delay an appropriate biopsy. Do not miss. Delay in diagnosis, fear of death, physical and psychological burden amongst the yet young cohorts who are yet to blossom in their life, inability to make these patients comprehend, understand as to how they got succumbed to oral cancer due to lack of evidence at present are some of the concerns that would always echo the clinicians in the years to come. So future in care, further studies on de-escalation therapy, that means transoral robotic surgery, might be a suitable option. After all, remedy should always be better than malady. To limit the price of cure, identify these oropharyngeal malignancies in a pre-neoplastic stage, a check on over-diagnosis and over-treatment of oral cancer. Now, there are some questions that are still unanswered, that is the clearance rate of an oral HPV infection, the latency period between infection and carcinogenesis. Because HPV can attack any individual, it is upon the immune susceptibility of that patient that makes him prone for high-risk HPV. So the percentage risk of person developing malignancy once infected is still not known. At present, we are treating the same disease, but the circumstances seems to be different. Thank you everyone for your patient listening.
You know the prognosis of HPV positive and negative, it is quite
So HPV-induced prognosis is usually better when compared to the non-HPV-induced oral cancers. So there can be different reasons. One is the absence of field cancerization in these patients. And then they usually have a better prognosis when compared to better treatment with radiation and chemotherapy seems to be more effective in these patients. And more often they seem to be younger patients with absolute lack of comorbidities, what we commonly see in middle-aged and elderly patients.
Recent sequencing data showed that at the late stage of HPV positivity, the genetic profile is very similar to HPV negative. So again, finally, and another point is in USA from 1990 to 2015, there was 30% decrease in cancer-related mortality for cervical cancer. These are breast cancer, colorectal cancer, and lung cancer. And this happened not because of improvement of therapy; it happened because of effective prevention. We can also follow the same strategy here to improve the scenario.
So currently there are vaccines that are being available, but they do not seem to be that effective when compared to these cervical cancers. Because usually they are supposed to be given prior to the onset of sexual activity at the age of 9 to 10.
Thank you, gentlemen, for giving us so well description, isn't it? Can I have a round of applause for the doctor? Thank you so much. So now we are proceeding to next speaker. Dr. Neha Mathur is going to speak about Caryotrophic fungi, the role of environmental ecology. I welcome the man